question was for DevOps administrator, DevOps engineer, or it was for Jenkins administrator. So most of questions are related to Jenkins only.
No. These are few questions which I can recollect at the moment, and also they have touched a point where can you explain about the migration process if somebody is interested to migrate their environment into cloud?
Okay, so first of all, let me tell you that what we are going to discuss today. So today we are going to discuss about the infrastructure side, right? And apart from infrastructure, we are going to touch upon the particular component. Why do we use it? What sort of component do we have and everything, right? So we are going to touch upon these things. So when someone is going to ask you that, okay, can you please help us with your infrastructure understanding? Like how is your infrastructure working? So these sort of questions usually we face, right? So how do we need to explain? So guys, the very first thing here is that we have a particular component which is known as DNS. So in our case, we are using Route 53.
Sorry to interrupt, is the meeting being recorded?
Yes, it is getting recorded.
Okay, sorry.
Completely fine. So like in our case, we are going to use Route 53. So when you are explaining the particular question, you will not use this line that in our case. So you will definitely say that obviously the particular journey of our infrastructure starts from DNS and we are using Route 53. Then we have different sort of services. So the particular initial level of services what we are serving here is, these are going to load balancer. So obviously you will say here ELB, and in the meanwhile you will explain here that we are using two type of load balancers. The very first one is going to be application, like application load balancer, and second one is going to be like network load balancer. We are going to discuss the particular use case later on today only, but yes, within this session only we are going to discuss, but for now you are going to say that the particular requests are routed to load balancer. Fine. But yes, when we are talking about like load balancer, so there is one more component which is very, very critical, that we are using here EC2 machines, because most of services are running on EC2. Why do we say most of services are running on EC2? So it could be possible that you are not only using EC2 machine in your organization, but you are using some sort of containerization application as well, right? So what we have to say, that first of all, request comes to DNS. DNS forward this request to load balancer. Now load balancer has different type of rules configured based on host and based on path. So let me define here like host and path. So this sort of routing we do on the top of this load balancer. So yes, we have done this sort of routing here. We have multiple target groups. So TG we will have to define here. Someone has joined, so let me accept that particular request. Yes. So yes. So when we are talking about like we have DNS, we have load balancer, we have target groups. So there would be another question, that how many servers do you have in your target group? Let me explain that question right away. So guys, we have different sort of servers based on the like number, like amount of traffic we have. So first of all, you are going to say that obviously in general, because we are working or we are dealing with either a service based organization or a particular product based organization. If it is service based, that we do not have end customer users, only registered users are supposed to visit our website, then the particular amount of servers are going to be maybe minimum 2. Desired is going to be 3, and maximum number of servers is going to be 5. Keep this thing in mind. If you are dealing with like a specific number of users and you do not have a very high frequency of traffic, you do not have very high amount of traffic, then this is going to be. But let us say if you are dealing in such an organization where like you are dealing with maybe Jabong, maybe you are dealing with Snapdeal, right? Or maybe any sort of organization where you do not have a particular trend of customer, they can come up anytime. If there is a particular sale going to be, so like number of servers are going to be higher, but in general you are going to say that minimum number of servers we have 10. Then after we talk about desired, so usually we have 15, and the maximum capacity we have up to 30. Why it is so? Because if there is a particular event going to happen, if there is a particular message which goes on from the side of our marketing team in market, so suddenly if there is a particular spike in traffic, so we have this amount of servers running into our target group. Minimum are going to be 10, because obviously we have this much amount of users, that definitely these number of servers are minimum required. Then after we have 15 at desired and 30 we have maximum. Do we have any questions on this?
So in each of the target groups, the count is minimum 15 and maximum 30.
I was waiting for this question only. So we have two target groups here. The very first target group, which is handling like end user customer. So let me define here like end user. So the particular target group which is responsible to handle the traffic of end users target group. So over here we are going to have this sort of configuration, but there will be another sort of server which is going to be for internal. Maybe we can call it admin. So where from we are handling the particular stuff which we are serving, right? So that particular server is not going to have that much. So obviously we will have minimum number of server as 2. Because obviously like the internal team is working on that. We have desired capacity as 3. And maximum we have 4, because we know very well that if there is a particular requirement, then we can add the servers on the fly, on demand. But really we do not want to have a lot of servers. Why it is so? Because when we know there is no load on this server, so it is of no use to burn a lot of amount of money in order to run 4 servers here, right? So what you will do here is, so we have set up a rule that if the particular path contains less admin, let us say the particular domain which we are talking about is, so let us take example of servergun.com. Right, so servergun.com is a particular domain which we are talking about. So let us say if the particular user is going to enter www.servergun.com, so there is going to be host based routing and request will be redirected here. Like end user target group where we have multiple instances running. Second thing we have here, like if the particular user is going to enter like /admin. So that particular request will be redirected onto some different target group which is going to be like over here we are going to do path based routing.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, implementation wise, what you are saying is initially, sir, the target group hota hai, that will contain our EC2 servers only. Correct, na, sir?
Yes, yes.
And sir, jab hum when we go in the load balancer, wahan pe ek section hota hai listener ka, jahan edit karte hain. So there is a plus symbol on the top. When you click on it, the rules will happen. So are you talking about that rules?
So if I talk about load balancer, so there are 2 rules. So when we go to like routing policies, so like view and edit rule, there's a particular section under target group, right? So over there we can define these sort of rules there. So either host based routing we are going to do, or either path based routing we are going to do. Right?
Yes, sir, you are correct. And target group only in listener section.
Yes, under listener section we have a particular setting where we can define host-based routing, path-based routing, even source IP-based routing, even the request-based routing, whether that is GET or POST, right? So that sort of thing we do. So either it could be like www.servergun.com/admin. So if we are focusing on /admin part, then this is going to be path-based routing. If we are using some sort of domain like admin.servergun.com, then it is going to be host-based routing. So I hope I'm clear with the example.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir, what is about database? What database you are using?
Wait. Coming on to that particular section. So, guys, the particular components which we are going to discuss in this particular session, so that is going to be end-to-end only, when I'm going to tell you that what sort of database are being used in your organization for which sort of application. Right? So, need not to worry about that particular part. So, as and when I'll complete this session, so even it could be possible that we might discuss the same sort of scenario tomorrow as well. Why it is so? Because this is going to be a very, very critical part. Right? So when we are talking about like admin section, because we have very limited number of users, so minimum two servers are going to be sufficient for this, right? These are going to be like, it could be a front-end server, or it could be your maybe Nginx server. It could be, for example, let us type in here. These are going to be Nginx. So I'm going to define here as Nginx server, that these are going to be, or maybe web server. Rather than defining is Nginx, we can define your web server, because see, we can use either Apache, Nginx, or any sort of web server. Same thing will be applied here. So even we will have web server here as well, because why it is so? Whether it is going to be for admin or whether it is going to be for your application server. So end of the day, web server will be there. Now the particular next target group which we are going to have, so we are going to have here like internal app server we are going to have. Now, I-N-T-E-R and AR, internal apps of application server we have. So what sort of application do we use here? So guys, there are two things. First of all, the particular component which is going to handle the request from end user, that is going to be like front end server, that is known as web server, could be Nginx or Tomcat, right? Maybe Apache we can have. And second server, but guys, keep this thing in mind. Whatever application flow you are going to draw, so you are going to be like, you will have to be stick to same sort of software. Like if we are using an Nginx here, so like even admin or maybe the particular like actual end user server
sir,
is going to have
screen same. Share kar rahe ho kya matlab, are you sharing the screen?
Yes, I did.
Because
I was drawing the things for you guys. Need not to worry.
Sir, अब एक बार बता दो सर, अब क्या करें
sir? Sure, sure. Need not to worry. That was my mistake. I did not ask you guys. But yes, I would love to explain it again. So guys, when we talk about the particular request, so the request is, this is going to be complete infrastructure program, right? So when we talk about like we have a DNS, we are talking about servercan.com domain, right? This is a particular domain which we are talking about. So if request comes for www.servercan.com, this is going to be for like request will be resolved by DNS. We are using Route 53 in our case. We have application load balancer. We have two type of like routing here, either host based or path based routing. Then after we have end user target group. Over here we are going to have 10, 15 or 30 web servers. Then after we have like admin target group, we have three minimum two, desired three and maximum four web servers we are having here. Why it is we have like restricted user here, only those users who are authenticated can log into this particular section, which is admin. So this URL could be any, either we are running like admin.servercan.com, that could be URL, or www.servercan.com/admin, that could be a URL here, right? Now when we talk about this application load balancer over here, we are going to do routing. We will send a request either to this target group or to this target group. Now once again, when we are talking about application server, so what this is going to happen? So guys, we are going to have internal server here. This is going to be application server. Let me type in here app. Why it is so? So it could be maybe any sort of service. It could be maybe it is going to be, let us say we are talking about any sort of e-commerce website, right? So how we are going to define here? So guys, we are going to use this internal application server. And this is going to be maybe your Java application server, it could be a Tomcat application server, it could be WebLogic, it could be Magento, it could be WordPress. So any sort of application it could be, wherever your business logic is running, that is going to be your application server, right? Are we clear with this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now when we talk about that, we have internal application server and we have like web servers as well. So how do we handle, like when do we talk about 10, 15 and 30? So how we are going to manage it? This is going to be a particular section. This can be discussed during interview. So guys, we are going to have a particular component known as auto scaling group. So I'm going to define here only ASG. I'm not going to define here auto scaling group. I would like to call it as ASG only, right? But now a person would ask you definitely, if you talk about auto scaling group, a person is going to ask you, so let us say when you are running one auto scaling group here and there is going to be a deployment. So how do you handle things? This particular section you will have to manage here. So what you are going to say, let us say if you are doing deployment with the help of Jenkins and you are not going to like remove the servers, you are going to do in place deployment, like all the servers are going to remain same and you are just going to replace the particular var or maybe jar file, or let us say if you have any sort of front end code you are going to replace. So what would happen with auto scaling group? Let us say if there is high load on server, so it will be responsible to remove old server and it will create new server. That is the basic work of auto scaling group, right?
Yes.
So what would happen in that case? So now it could be possible that auto scaling group is going to provision a new server, but the particular new server will be created with old image, right? So in
yes.
That case, what happens as and when we do a deployment, so we have to suspend this auto scaling group. There is a particular section in AWS wherein we can suspend the auto scaling group, right? So after suspending auto scaling group, we are going to do deployment. Now what we are going to do, once the deployment is done, we will create one AMI out of any of these application server. Obviously, before creating image, because it could be possible that that particular server might get rebooted or whatsoever happens with that. So we are not going to worry about that. We are going to create one image out of that particular server, which is containing latest code. Now, if we are very clear with autoscale with AWS, then AWS has two more components, like it has like LT or like it, either it has launch configuration, launch template, or it has. Guys, what is second component we use with auto scaling group?
Sir, ek schedule bhi hota hai sir. Scheduler is something.
So scheduler is something different. Scheduler is something different. So either it has launch template or launch configuration. So LT will stand for launch template, and LC will stand for launch configuration. So whatever component we are using, either configuration or we are using template, so any of the component we will definitely use. Without these two, we cannot create auto scaling group, right? So that new AMI which we are going to create, so that will be handed over to this launch template or launch configuration. The particular image which we are going to create out of this particular web server, wherever we have deployed the code, that particular image will be updated within launch configuration or launch template. And now whenever we are going to resume this auto scaling group, so for sure that is going to launch new server for us with the latest code available.
So when we suspend that particular auto scaling group during deployment, won't we be facing any issues, or are there probably
not actually? So what happens, there are certain actions. For example, it will stop monitoring your infrastructure. It will stop terminating servers. It will stop provisioning new servers. All the existing servers will not be touched upon. Whatever is running, that will keep on running. We are not going to face any sort of issues here.
Yeah, okay. And one more thing, Lokendra, I missed, what will happen if we do not suspend ASG and deploy, if we carry out deployment? Can you say that once again?
Yeah, for sure. So let us say if we do not suspend auto scaling group, and let us say we have only two servers in auto scaling for hypothetical situation, right? So what if one server we have deployed, and during the time of deployment, service will definitely get filled for some time. Like if we are doing in-place deployment, we are not going to replace the servers. So it could be possible that the particular server might be unresponsive. Auto scaling group will definitely terminate that, because based on the rule, if the server is not responsive, it will terminate the server. Once again, it will launch the server with previous template, with previous launch, with previous AMI, with old AMI. It will not contain the latest code. Once again, you will perform the same stuff. It will once again terminate the server as soon as server will be offline. So there will be a loop, right? During deployment, if there is a downtime expected, and if the downtime is observed by auto scaling, so definitely it is going to terminate those servers and it will launch new server, and obviously new server will be with the old code. So that is why we have to suspend this auto scaling group.
Can I say that in this way, to maintain uniformity among the servers, we are suspending auto scaling group?
Yes.
During deployment.
Yes, during deployment. And why it is so? Because we do not want that any server should be suspended. For example, if there is a particular, we have some sort of application, that application comes up after 5 minutes. For example, we are using any monolithic application, and the particular startup time of that application is 5 minutes. So what is going to happen in that case? We are going to say that rather than facing this sort of challenges that we are facing, auto termination of the instances, we are going to suspend this auto scaling group. And rather than saying that we are going to deploy on all the servers, so out of these 10 servers, we will take one server out of the pool. We will do deployment onto that. We will create image out of this particular. And after that, we will update that image in launch template. And after that, we will instruct this auto scaling group to refresh the instances. So it will keep on terminating new, like existing instance. And in place of that, it is going to create new instances. So even as of today, auto scaling group provides this feature that we can refresh the instances.
Sir, we have to do that manually or
automatically? Automatically. So why it is so? So let us say the particular. Let us say how we are going to perform this sort of thing. So guys, there will be a particular new component introduced here. that is going to be Jenkins, that is going to be out of AWS. Either that, obviously, like you can create that Jenkins server anywhere in this AWS infrastructure, right? But obviously that is not going to be a server which is going to be responsible to hold customer data, right? So you can keep that server apart, you can keep that server aside. So now Jenkins server will have access to like AWS auto scaling group, Jenkins will have access to like EC2 machines. Whenever like you are going to do a deployment, you are going to trigger a deployment, first of the very first action which you are going to perform, you are going to send a request, you are going to send a command that whenever the deployment will be triggered, so first of all auto scaling group will be suspended. Like certain action in auto scaling group, like termination of servers, like creation of new server, like monitoring of the server, so couple of actions you will definitely suspend. So if you guys are not able to imagine that, so let me go for console.aws.amazon.com. I'm going to open my account and I'll show you that what are the particular terminology which I'm talking about. I hope that will be much better for you guys.
Sir, thoda clear karne ke liye, like what I know is we can also boot from some AMI image. So what you mean is like in case of deployment, wait, already that image and all kind of dependencies are already there. So just it needs a refresh rather than wait for 10 minutes and then the application boots up, right?
It is so not like that. The particular image which you are telling that is already updated within launch template and launch configuration.
Okay. So right. Already everything
but
is ready.
Everything is ready. So let us say if there is a deployment. So what does deployment mean? It means we are going to push new code to production environment, right?
Yes.
That is how it makes sense that we are going to go for deployment, right? So now when we are talking about that, we have to send a latest code. So how we are going to send that code? So first of all, we will send the particular code to the server, and during the code sending, code refreshment, what if the particular auto scaling group is going to terminate that server, right? So what we are going to do, so in case if we are using Jenkins and we are doing in-place deployment. In-place deployment means the particular servers are going to be there, we are not going to terminate existing servers, we are not going to create parallel servers. And obviously this is going to be for cost optimization for sure. So if we are not going to terminate existing servers, we are not going to create parallel servers, we do not want to terminate existing. So in that case, what we are going to do, we will suspend auto scaling group, we will do deployment here, and after that we are going to update the image of that one server where we did deployment with the help of Jenkins. That particular image will be updated within launch template or launch configuration. Now we will go for refreshment. Let me show you how.
Actually, this was the question. One of the questions that I got from interview, like how do you do the cost optimization, which I got clear now.
So I'm sorry to say, but this is not the only option for cost optimization. I'll tell you that thing as well.
Okay.
Sir, I know two ways. But is there something NAT instance also, na? जिससे कॉस्ट ऑप्टिमाइजेशन होता है.
नेट इंस्टेंस इज नॉट लाइक समथिंग दैट इज नोन एज लाइक स्पॉट इंस्टेंसेस.
नहीं सर, जैसे हम लोग नेट गेटवे लगाते हैं ना, बिकॉज़ दीस टू विल बी वेरी कंपल्सरी. सो
व्हाट आर द अल्फाबेट्स? 2 जी एफ बी, इज इट वी और वाई?
एक्स सर.
That was why.
Sir, correct me on this question, sir. The two ways of cost optimization are like, since the NAT gateway or a NAT instance, right? Option is there, I understand. But NAT gateway is maintained by AWS and it is available in like all, at least you have to put in two availability zones in the production, right? So agar ek availability zone mein fail hota hai, toh dusre availability zone mein bhi NAT, we need a NAT gateway. So it will be costly thing. But in production, it's okay. But in real time, we are in testing and these all things, then we can use the NAT instance. So this will save cost, right?
Not exactly. So I completely agree with you that NAT instance is going to be a little cheaper than that of NAT gateway, but NAT, that is not the single component, that is how we are going to save cost. I'll tell you that, you don't have to worry.
Okay. बाकी सर एक सर्वरलेस भी मैंने सुना है, सर्वरलेस से
दैट इज लैम्डा, दैट इज लैम्डा, दैट इज समथिंग एल्स.
ओके, लाइक आई मीन ऑल टाइम EC2 वोंट बी रनिंग, लाइक व्हाटएवर टाइम फॉर अ फंक्शन यू लाइक 8 आवर्स पूरा नहीं चलेगा, लाइक व्हाटएवर थिंग यू नीड इट विल रन फॉर 3 आवर्स एंड इट विल स्टॉप. सो दैट इज अनदर वे ऑफ कॉस्ट ऑप्टिमाइजेशन, राइट, in the serverless way or something,
lambda. Yes, way. That is, but that is to serve only some sort of APIs only, nothing more than that. Need not to worry, I'll come on to that part as well.
Are sir costly to sab kuch hai sir, they ask for the cost sir.
Oh really, even I was asked today during my interview.
Please don't forget to share your interview questions with
us. Yes, definitely. So I'm going to add those sort of questions today sir. So this is not going to be my use case, this is not going to be my profile, and obviously what sort of AMI I have selected here. Guys, just a moment, getting a call. Hello? Yeah, hi. Hi Sangeeta. It was good, I hope you called, so definitely. It was good from my side. What time do you want? So I'll check my calendar and let you know. Six or 6:30 will do. So we can go for that. Yes. Yeah, that sounds good. Okay. Bye bye. Cool. So okay guys. So I was talking about I hope guys you can still see my screen, right?
Yes.
So I was talking about that some sort of AMI I should be taking care of. So let me figure out here Red Hat if there is any. So obviously guys, when I'm not going to like boot this sort of server, so I need not to worry about it, right? So yes, I'll have to select a key pair as well. Oh, this is North Virginia. Oh my God. I was supposed to work in Mumbai only. So guys, I'm going to create a launch configuration first, and after that, definitely we will go ahead. That is Mumbai, and over here, I'm going to create launch configuration first. I'll go to create launch configuration. I'll define a name here, maybe demo. And AMI I will choose here. The instance type I'll select here, ST2. Dot micro, this is going to be for free tier. If you would like to go for any purchasing option and all, monitoring, EBS optimized, I don't want to go for it. I cannot delete any sort of these volumes from here. This is going to be security group name. I can select an existing one. I'll go with my default security group that allows everything. Right, choose a key pair name. This is going to be fix my infra. I'll select create launch template. Guys, this is not production ready, let me tell you. This is just like I'm creating in order to demonstrate that how do we handle the secure that particular part, right? So this is not production ready. The particular major part which I was supposed to tell you here is that we are going to talk about the refresh option. As I was trying to explain you here that we can refresh this server, so how do we do that? That's the particular part which I'm going to show you. So obviously I'll define a name like interview, interview prep. This is going to be a launch template, launch configuration here, right? Then after version, it is going to say remaining options are going to remain same. Yes, guys, that sort of option do we also have here. So like rather than having only one type of instance, you can have a combination of instances. Like how many on, like what percent, what like on-demand instances. Let us say I would like to have 3. So you can define it like what percentage of on-demand you would like to have. Total number of instances are going to be 3. So what percentage of on-demand you would like to have? 70%. And what percent of spot instance you would like to have, right? So let us say I want here like these many instances, like 40% spot and 60% on-demand I would like to have here. So let us say if I'm going to have 10 instances here, so this is going to run like 6 on-demand and 4 spot. And obviously like if something goes wrong, if something goes wrong, so at least 60% instance I have which will be running as on demand. So if spot instances are terminated and created once again, so definitely guys I need not to worry about that part, right guys?
Yes.
So obviously we can select here like capacity optimized recommended. So what it is going to do, like launch spot instances optimally based on the available like spot capacity. Moreover, like lowest price. So if you talk about like lowest price, we can pick it here. Like let us say we have selected different type of instances here. So based on the particular cost, it will start from the least expensive instance. So this is also going to be a particular part for cost optimization, because see, we are not going to run our 10 instances based on like on demand. We are going to have a combination of on demand and spot both. So when you are explaining that the particular instance which you are running in terms of cost optimization, you can define this particular part as well, that you are running a combination of instances within this particular component, like 4 instances are running as spot and 6 are running as on demand.
Is this the only combination we use, or any more instance types we use here, on demand or spot, apart from this?
So we have these type of instances here. We can add multiple type of instances. Like we have T2 micro, we can select any other one as well.
No. I'm talking about the on-demand and spot.
Yes, so definitely we have only these two options here. Why okay. It is so? If we talk about like cost optimization options, so we have different type of settings here. Like we have 4 major options. We have on-demand, we have reserve instances, we have savings plan, and we have spot, right?
Yes.
So let us say if you do not have reserve instance or you do not have saving plan in your account, so definitely what is going to happen? You are going to use only the particular option which is on demand. But now
but where is the reserved option here?
Pardon?
Where is the reserved instances option here mentioned?
We have here under this particular section. We can go to purchase reserve instances.
Okay.
We can purchase reserved instances here at this particular section, right?
So you define 10 instances right now. So among those 10, 6 are on demand and 4 are spot.
Yes.
So these are separately defined apart from the reserve instances again. Am I correct?
No, these are not. So let us say when we have a reserve instance, let us say I'm going to purchase a reserve instance, right? Let me show you that part as well. So this is going to be Linux operating system. Type is going to be T2 micro. And obviously, let us say I'm going to have like any sort of this one instance I'm going to have here, right? Any random, because I'm not going to purchase for sure. Right, so when I have these sort of instances here, so like only show offerings, like what sort of offering do I have in this particular region? So like what sort of component do I need to select, like availability zone? Obviously this will be this one. Term is going to be maybe for 1 year. Then tenancy is going to be like dedicated or default. I would like to have default. Payment option, what I am going to have, like no upfront. Like offering class, I have like this convertible or standard, so obviously I would like to have convertible. And when I search these sort of instances, so obviously like add to cart, I'll search this sort of instances. This is going to be like effective rate, this is going to be this much. Hourly rate is going to be this much. So like quantity available, unlimited, I can select as many as I want here, right? I'll add it to my cart, and after that I will purchase it. So let us say once I have a particular dedicate like reserve instance in my cart, once I have purchased an instance, and if I'm going to select same sort of instance type in the particular template here, so as soon as I will boot that instance, so that instance will be created as reserve instance. But let us say if I have only 5 instances as reserve, but my requirement says that I need to boot more, then what would happen? In that case, guys, what is going to happen that we are going to be charged based on on-demand rate. Are we clear that?
Yeah.
Second thing, let us say now we have savings plan as well. Apart from our 5 reserve instances, we have on-demand, like we have savings plan as well. So how does saving plan work? So guys, saving plan is another option here. Let me show you under billing section. I'm going to show you my billing dashboard. That is going to be shocking news for me. Oh wow, this is how much I'm going to pay this month.
This is really shocking.
And see last month bill, $2.88. That is pathetic. I'll have to take some loans to pay off. Well, that was just jokes apart. So guys, I'm talking about this particular section, savings plan. So guys, how saving plan is different from our reserve instance? So guys, as I just explained that we can purchase a savings plan, like reserve instance here, right? So irrespective of the particular reason, the availability zone, the particular type of instance, we commit to AWS just compute power. That we commit that we are going to use EC2 resources in term of like CPU, in term of memory, in term of network, in term of everything, right? And we are going to pay $10 per hour. For example, we commit that we will pay $10 per hour in order to use compute power. So what does it mean, guys? So obviously AWS will offer cheaper rates because right now we have made a commitment. So see guys, if we talk about like if we reserve instance, if we are going to be a little more conservative, like we are going to say that we are going to use like Mumbai. If we are going to use Mumbai as available as a reason, if we are going to say that we are going to use AP Southeast 1A as availability zone, we are going to select any sort of instance family. So that is going to be more cheaper. So overall in compute, we are going to get 66% approx discount. But in case of like reservation, and that is too conservative, so we are going to have 72%. Although that is not fixed, it could be vary, like it could be like 64%, it could be like 68%. That will be depending upon the particular availability of the instances and other commitments which we are going to make. Right guys? So I hope we are clear with like reserve difference between reserve instance and the savings plan.
Yes.
Fine. So what does it mean? It means if we have the very first 5 instances are going to be created, that it will be created under reserve instance. If reserve instances are already running and we would like to increase number of instances from 10 to 15. So what is going to happen? Remaining instances will be created under savings plan option, right? But now let us say the particular requirement which we have that is not getting fulfilled. So let us say that we can run 20 more instances under savings plan, right? So what if we need to boot more instances then? What would happen in that case? So guys, if we are going to have more and more instances, in that case, AWS will start charging us as per the price of on-demand instances. First of all, reserve instance will be preferred. Then after savings plan will be preferred. Then after it will go to on-demand section. And yes, guys, keep this thing in mind. All the spot instances are charged based on the spot instance price only. These particular charges are not covered under your on-demand, under your reserve instance, under your savings plan. Spot instances are always charged separately. So for example, if you have savings plan in your account, for example, if you have reserve instances in your accounts and you know that you are not using your savings plan and your reserve instance 100%, it is not recommended to go with spot instances. Although these are really, really cheap, but do not ever go with spot instances until and unless you have that sort of section in your account. Are we clear with that?
Yes, clear.
Fine. Yes. So guys, now we can, as we can see, we have three type of instances. I'm going to have only two. So even we can have multiple different type of instances here. So whatever you want, you can go with, right? So now let us go ahead. So we are going to select VPC. We are going to select subnet here. That what sort of subnet we are going to select in case of in order to create our instances in. I'll hit next here. Like, do you want to attach a load balancer? Yes, definitely. I'll attach a load balancer here. Like, what is going to happen if I have a target group here? So I can easily select a target group that under which target group I would like to create my auto scaling group. Then after, the particular monitoring section will be from load balancer and EC2 both. Then after, I'm going to go to next target group. I'll have to create it. Just allow me to have a second, guys. I'm going to create a target group here quickly. I hope we shall be able to cover it in two.
Sir, but the topic is ASG, na? Auto scaling group. It is this topic, right? You are explaining. Or like full flow, I mean.
Full flow, I'm telling. So let us say if you are going to create auto scaling group, you will need a target group as well.
Okay.
So without allocating a target group, you will not be allowed to create a particular auto scaling group. So let us say if you are going to boot servers. So where you are going to create servers? Obviously, that will be created under target group only. And that target group will be associated with your AWS load balancer. So guys, I'm going to refresh this. Right, this is the particular target group where new instance will be created. I'll go next. I'll keep it like minimum desired capacity one, minimum one, and maximum is going to be, let us say, desired is going to be zero, and minimum is going to be zero, and maximum is going to be zero. I do not want to create any server here. So now I'll hit next, and I'll hit next here. I'll hit next, and I'll hit finally create auto scaling group. So guys, this is okay. I'll have to add this one to maximum to one.
Yes, sir. Nahi to fir auto scaling ka, like, what's the meaning of auto scaling? If zero
I was trying to save my cost.
Ek bana lo, sir. Ek se cost nahi aayegi.
No, it is not like that. Actually, what is going to happen here, if you remember, while I was creating configuring the particular group size, so obviously I defined somewhere like 10 instances. I defined 10 instances there.
Amazon ko mail kar dena, wo log, I mean, they leave the things like you are student and you are studying like that. You can do mail na?
Why to do that sort of thing? I was just trying to configure your number of instances, on-demand instances, zero. Earlier I kept here as 10. So yes, guys, as you see here, like, we have details of this particular auto scaling group. These are the activities. Like, obviously it is going to create one instance for me, right? It is failed because obviously the particular listener which I wanted to have, because I did not configure it to like launch instances, because I really did not want to have. Now automatic scaling, if you have, like, what are the policies do you have, right? Instance management. So let us say if there is an instance which you would like, and actions you can like set to standby. Once the instance is up and running properly, so obviously this is under pending state. So you can set it to date. You can detach from like or like target group. You can set it to standby. You can set it to service. You if you want that this server should not be terminated anyhow, then you can set this policy like instance scale in production enable, right? So these sort of options you have here for monitoring. You have these sort of monitoring stats here. Finally, you have instance refresh. So this option I was talking about, for example, if you have done a deployment on one server. So let us say if there are 10 servers and you have done deployment on one server, what you can do here is you can easily update the AMI of that server under launch template or launch configuration. Then after, what you will do, you will go to refresh instances, and after that start refresh instance. So once you will say that it will ask minimum healthy number of percentage are going to be like maybe 50. So if you have a particular very like flexibility, so definitely all the like 50% instances will be healthy all the times. Then after instance warm up time is going to be maybe 60 seconds. If you feel that instance can come up under 60 seconds, so you will have to define at least 120 seconds. So the particular time spent which your instance is going to take in order to come up, so obviously at least 60 seconds extra time you will have to define here. You will hit start, and obviously all the instance will be like started like refreshing. Like it will keep on creating new instances, and it will keep on deleting old instances. So this is how we refresh the stuff here, right? Are we clear with that?
Yes.
Now we have another type of load balancer here, and guys, that is going to be an NLB. Like we have another type of load balancer which is going to be a network load balancer. And why do we have? So all the application servers which are running here. So now this particular server, which is going to be our application server. So application server will send request to network load balancer. Now network load balancer is going to distribute load among this sort of stuff. When we talk about like this particular component is clear, right? So we can have some sort of rule here. We can have some sort of listener here. And based on those rule and listener, this particular network load balancer will send traffic here to these application servers, right? Now we have a particular database. So guys, in most of cases, if you are using any sort of like e-commerce website, then MySQL is the preferred one. So you can say that you are using MySQL database here. All the application servers will be responsible to get details from MySQL. So request will be sent to MySQL. All the requests will be forwarded to MySQL server. Right? This is how it works. But now guys, when we talk about like what other components you are using here, so definitely like these servers are running. So we will have to talk about monitoring section here. So you are using Prometheus to monitor servers and services. Guys, keep this thing in mind. A person might ask you that what sort of service you are using. So guys, you will have to answer here that you are using Prometheus in order to monitor infrastructure and the services.
Okay.
Now, there will be a question. Let us say if your application is not performing well and your application starts working slow, then how will you analyze it? So guys, you will have to say that you are using ELK with APM. So APM means application performance monitoring. So you are using ELK. So whenever there is a particular log, there is an activity on these servers. So this is going to send the particular logs to ELK. It means centralized log Elasticsearch log stash environment system you are using. Now based on the top of this, you have implemented APM, like application performance monitoring. So all the APIs which are going through, which are like providing data to end user on the top of this particular web server, on the top of this particular application server, web application database. So every single component will be sending the details and the statics to ELK, and ELK will be sharing database with APM, like application performance monitoring tool. So this is going to provide you information. For example, your application is working slow. So at least some or the other service will be responsible for it. End of the day, entire application is down. You never know whether it is web server, it is your application server or your database. So with the help of APM, you can easily identify that which particular component is serving slow or is working slow. Where is the particular load in the particular infrastructure? Are we clear with this, guys?
What are the probable scenarios that which particular component will be causing the slowness here?
Okay, so let us say like we have minimum number of server 5, right? And maximum number of servers are 15. Like let us reverse this particular section here, which is of instance numbers. Let us say we have minimum number of servers as 5, and desired we have maybe 6, and maximum we have maybe 8, right? So what if these 8 servers are not capable enough to handle the request which is coming currently? So there will be high load, and these particular servers cannot be scaled out or scaled in, whatever it is, right? So if these servers are not able to be scaled in, we cannot increase number of servers by default with the help of auto scaling group. So obviously, guys, there will be one auto scaling group here as well. So we will have an auto scaling group here as well, and on the top of these application servers, right? So let us say if this auto scaling group is not able to add new servers here, so it will start performing slow. We have 13 servers here, maybe we have 20 servers here, and we have 8 maximum of number of servers here. So in that case, this particular server will start performing slow. Right? It could be possible like web server is responding slow, your application server is working slow, or maybe your database is overloaded. So any possible scenario could be here. Right? So let us say if we are working in such sort of environment where let us say you have to modify the particular DNS configuration here, or maybe you are supposed to update any patch here, you are supposed to install one software on all the servers. So someone might definitely ask you that, okay, what sort of configuration management tool you guys are using? So guys, we are using Ansible. Right? So now guys, if you are going to face an interview on the top of all these sort of questions, on this sort of tool, a person might ask you, okay, why are you using Ansible? So guys, the particular appropriate answer to answer this question here is that it is not only me who is going to be responsible to handle complete infrastructure. We will have to think of from the perspective of our colleagues, or maybe the particular associate employees who are working with us. If I introduce maybe chef here and they are not comfortable, so obviously when we introduce any tool, so definitely that will go into production environment as well. So the particular production environment, when we try to hit the particular service into production environment, so we will have to take care of the particular team's part as well. That even our team, our colleagues should be responsible, should be able to handle the particular stuff. So that is why, based on the availability of the resources in our team, we decide a particular tool, that which tool we are going to go ahead, right? And finally, you will discuss that tool with management. You will have to you will have to go for advocating it, that why you are selecting this particular tool, and post the particular discussion, you select the particular tool that yes, this is the tool which we are going to go with. So moreover, the same thing can go with Jenkins as well. Someone might ask, okay, why you are using Jenkins in your environment? Why you are not using CircleCI, maybe Bamboo, maybe any other sort of tool here? So you will say that depends on the particular resources which are available in our organization, right? Resources in the sense the particular team members I'm talking about here, right? Okay. So this is about the complete application flow. Like we have DNS, we have application load balancer, we have auto scaling group, we have launch configuration or launch template we have. Then after, we have Jenkins for doing deployment here. Jenkins will be responsible to suspend auto scaling group before deployment, and once the deployment is done completely on one server, right? Or either you can say you take one server out of pool, you do deployment on that, you create AMI out of it. Once the AMI is created, so that particular Jenkins server is going to be responsible to update that AMI within launch template. After that, it will trigger. Once the launch template is triggered, so it is going to hit auto scaling group in order to go for refreshment. I hope that you guys are well known that how do we refresh instances. So there will be a couple of components here, maximum healthy percentage is going to be maybe 80%, and instance warm up time is going to be XYZ value here. So based on the particular Jenkins, once the particular AMI is created and that is updated within this launch configuration, launch template, you are going to initiate Jenkins to trigger the particular AWS auto scaling group refresh instance action. Are we clear with this, guys?
Yes.
So it means, just a moment, it means that no one is going to ask you that do you do these things manually. No, Jenkins is going to be responsible to take care of these things. And in order, let us say if development fails, then what is going to be rollback plan here, guys? So once again, you will do the same thing, like you have yet not deleted the previous AMI. You will just change the default version of this launch template under this auto scaling group. So if you see here, like every single launch template has a version. So if we talk about here, launch configuration, launch template. So guys, we have a version of that. So we can revert the version to previous as the default version for auto scaling group, and it will start picking the resources and the AMI from last template.
This is done through Jenkins, right?
Yes. Everything is done with the help of Jenkins. So let us say we can describe launch template version. So rather than we are using version number 18, that is latest. So what is going to be previous? Obviously 17. So like n minus 1 version we are going to define as a rollback process.
Okay.
Right. Then after, let us say if we are serving static content here, so there will be one more component that is going to be introduced right away. So that will be CDN. Content Delivery Network. So guys, in our case, you can say that you are using Akamai, you are using Cloudflare, you are using AWS CloudFront. So we are having a particular service here. In case of AWS, you can define that you are using CloudFront. You can define here that you are using AWS CloudFront service here. Right, guys? So as and when request comes, so if these are every request will go to CDN. Now CDN will decide. If it is going to be a static page, so definitely CDN will cache the data and will revert the particular request to user from here itself. And if the request is going to be dynamic, where database connection is required, so request will be forwarded to this particular host path, like load balancer, web app, internal application server, and database. Right?
Yeah.
Now, let us introduce two more tools here. Let us say we are talking about admin. So now admins are going to be responsible to update the things from backend. For example, you are working with any sort of that particular component where you are going to add some new products, right? So how you are going to add products here, guys? So all the products which are listed on the top of, let us say if I talk about here like Flipkart. Obviously, I'm not the authorized person to describe all these things, because it could be possible they might be using some different sort of components. But let us say we talk about like fashion or maybe the electronics, right? So I can talk about here. So these sort of things I'm going to talk about. So guys, if I start scrolling here, you will see that the particular internet is working really fast, either you can say, or the particular products are getting loaded very faster. So as soon as I go here, I start scrolling. So in the meanwhile, all the products are available. So guys, how does it happen? So in order to serve the product very faster, we can use Elasticsearch here. So Elasticsearch, the very first thing it was being used here for log management only, right? Like we were getting some logs. So now Elasticsearch can be used in order to cache the data.
Basically, Elasticsearch is a component of ELK, right?
Well, I must say that yes. But guys, when we are talking about, let us say that we have a lot of product to display, so we can store those products here as well within ELK. In order to make this particular search faster, in order to serve the data from RAM itself, we can use Elasticsearch component as a product listing component. So we will have all the products here in Elasticsearch, right? Now let us say if we are talking about we would like to have a very session management server. So we can talk about we are using Redis here. So Redis is going to be Redis can be used as a database here, and that will be storing all the data in memory, and that will be serving end users very faster. So guys, this is how we explain our project. So now it is up to you. If you have any question to ask, you can ask.
Sir, in this particular flow, what kind of Jenkins plugins we use?
So guys, the very first plugin which we are going to use here is going to be for sure GitHub. Like Git plugin we are going to use here. Then after, we are going to use AWS plugins, because obviously we will have to figure out the particular data from Amazon. For example, if we need to figure out the particular IP address detail of our server, that where we are going to do deployment. So Jenkins will be able to describe the particular components. So obviously, in order to define number of instances, we are going to use EC2 plugin with Jenkins. right? Then after we are going to use obviously like pipeline plugin and maybe Sonar Cube. Different plugins are there which we use in general. So that will be depending on the requirement only.
Sir, auto scaling group you told to suspend. So sir, that can be done with AWS plugin or which plugin?
So let us say if we have AWS EC2 plugin integrated with Jenkins, only then Jenkins will be able to describe auto scaling group. And now when it can describe auto scaling group with the help of AWS CLI commands, only then from the Jenkins CLI you will be able to figure out the servers.
Okay. So I mean we have to use Jenkins CLI, right, for this?
So not Jenkins CLI, you can define the particular command on Jenkins GUI only, but obviously in order to interact with AWS CLI, you will have to use AWS CLI commands only. And those commands you can define within a job as a particular step in your pipeline.
Okay.
So as you remember that there are multiple stages in Jenkins pipeline, right?
Yes.
So within a particular stage, we can define a step as a suspend auto scaling group. Next, go for deployment. So suspending auto scaling group is going to be first stage. And under that stage, we can define a particular command as a step. Second stage is going to be deploy code to EC2 machine. So in that particular, how you are going to fetch the IP address of servers. Because see, we do not have any static IP address over here. We are going to have dynamic IP addresses. And in case, if you are going to fetch the detail of this service, you are going to use AWS EC2 Jenkins plugin.
Okay.
Yes. So that is how it works. Please go ahead.
Yeah, if the interviewer is asking you in this way, can you please talk about something related to security of your infrastructure?
Yes.
What should be?
Yes. So what you are going to say here is, so obviously you will say that you have integrated WAF here. So you have integrated WAF and Shield. WAF means web application firewall you have integrated, and Shield as well. So Shield is going to protect your product from SQL injection, maybe DDoS attack, or maybe any other sort of security assessment you can perform here on the top of WAF and Shield, right? Then after load balancer, so it is going to accept traffic from on port 80 from 0.0.0.0 on port 80 and 443. So this is going to accept traffic from everywhere. Moreover, all the instances which are running under this target group, so these are going to accept traffic on port 80 and 443 from this load balancer only. And maybe from your couple of other IP addresses as well. Let us say if you do not want to go through load balancer, you are going to go for some testing. So you can directly access these instances from your that particular security group which is associated here. That particular will accept traffic either from load balancer or from your office IP addresses or any individual IP address which is associated with that instance. But yes, port 80 will be exposed to load balancer only, or maybe 443. Same thing will be applied here. Now in case this is going to be a particular responsible application in order to serve this particular user or to serve this sort of request. So now in that particular case, it is going to allow to accept traffic from these particular users or either from your on-prem data center or maybe from your on-prem office. Same thing will be applied with MySQL. So in case of MySQL, what we are going to do, we are going to connect MySQL with these application servers, and MySQL security group will allow to connect either from on-prem or from internal application server, because there is no other application server going to be there who is going to connect to this MySQL database.
Sir, I have one small question.
Please.
Sir, actually, from your video, I just saw something with Bastion host. But sir, I saw in YouTube they are saying this is okay for now, but this is not how we create in production. So sir, you are working in production. So sir, how we create the Bastion host in the production, sir?
So the same way as I explained in that video, we are using Jenkins that sort of server in our environment.
So sir, there will be one separate server and we will...
We will not have any sort of customer data on the top of that server, but yes, we are going to use that server in order to access remaining resources. So are we clear with this particular flow, guys? That how does it work?
Yes, this is clear flow, Kendra. This is comfortable. We can explain this flow. So what if he asks? Okay, fine. What are your roles and what do you do daily once you log in? Some tasks. that.
Wait, let me tell you one more thing here. I am itching for that. I feel like telling it. So for example, if you have single MySQL server, there is high load. So how you are going to scale it?
Create replicas.
I think we are not going to scale database servers if I'm correct.
But if there is a requirement to scale, then?
Sir, read replicas.
That is perfect answer. Read replica. But guys, let us say that if
I'm slave का scaling तो होता है ना sir. Slaves are scaled, I think, right? It's happening.
No, actually, you are not right at that particular point. If you say that you are going to scale up these sort of things, then definitely I would not recommend your answer to anyone. Why it is so? Let us say that if you add one more scale, then how will you notify this application server to send read request onto the server as well?
So, sir, master ke saath, if you want to, suppose load increases in the database, like tomorrow I have 3, like today I have 2 trillion, tomorrow I have 3 trillion. I have some plan like now, so I have to scale master also then, right? Master and slave both.
Obviously, you will have to scale master server. You will have to add multiple read replicas here, right? But how you are going to notify your application server that if there is a particular select query, then read onto this new server? How will you notify that new server is added to this internal application server?
Sir, the DNS, the endpoint of database server is same for all replicas.
Proxy SQL is going to be the answer. So now what would happen here? Like this is going to be load balancer on the top of SQL. So what would happen, guys? Each and every request, whatever we are going to forward. So first of all, we will forward the request to Proxy SQL only, like this. Every single request will be forwarded to Proxy SQL. Now Proxy SQL is going to decide if it is an update, insert, alter, or any other sort of query. Then it will be redirected to master. Let me define here master. Right, so if it is going to be like update, insert, alter, like anything apart from read, then it is going to go to this particular server. And now if it is going to be select, so it is going to this server. For example, 90% requests in any organization are related to select only, where we are trying to read the data. So now this particular server will understand these servers based on the particular ID, like server ID like 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Or let us see if I'm going to add one new server here. So right now I need to modify the particular detail of that particular server in this particular application server. What I'll do here is I will add a new particular server here, and I will add the detail of this server within Proxy SQL. So I need not to like make any modification within internal application. Like the application property files, I'm not going to modify. I'm going to use here Proxy SQL. Right now there will be a question, so don't you feel that this Proxy SQL will become a bottleneck? Let us say if this goes down, then what would happen? So guys, in that particular case, we are going to say that we are not using Proxy SQL as a single instance. We have created a replica of this particular server as a Proxy SQL, and on the top of that we are going to have a particular network load balancer once again, because see, this is going to work on port number. What port number it is going to work on?
Sir, 3306, I think.
MySQL works on port number 3306, but let us say Proxy is going to run on 6033 port number. So these applications are going to access Proxy SQL on port number 6033, or maybe any other random port it is going to hit on. Now this network load balancer is going to be responsible to ensure the state of these two servers. For example, if there is a particular component which is known as launch template, launch configuration, so that will be available here, right? Finally, we have order scaling group. So this order scaling group is going to be responsible in order to manage the particular target which are under this target group, like 2 Proxy SQL. If one Proxy SQL server goes down, another will be up. If this goes down, another will be up. And let us say both goes down, then this order scaling group is going to be responsible to provision same server once again, because these are identical. All the rules which are associated here, same rules will be implemented here as well. And now we can pass the network load balancer detail to this particular applications rather than specifying individual load balancer details here. So guys,
exactly we pass the details. for the application server?
So like we will have to configure, like let us say we configure like what is the particular detail of master, like MySQL master, right? So proxy server is not, so guys, proxy server is actually not going to modify anything there. We, you guys, just a moment. Hello? 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 Haan bolo. Guys, just hold on for a sec. Haan bolo. Batch padha raha hu bhai. 9:30 baje, 10:30 baje. हेलो बोलो हेलो 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 यस गाइस सो व्हाट हैपेंस गाइस कैन यू हियर मी
Yes.
Okay, great. So guys, when we are talking about this, so let us say right now we are going to provide the details. Like let us say if we have to define the particular endpoint, like where the particular database is running, we are going to define the load balancer detail, like maybe DNS, name of this load balancer. Then after we are going to define that request will go to load balancer. This load balancer will have only these two servers inside the target group. The state of these two servers will be managed by auto scaling group, right? And based on the rules which are defined here, so let us say this particular proxy server is going to define, is going to identify these servers with the help of their IDs only, right? So we can have multiple masters here, we can have multiple slaves, so we need to modify the particular settings in proxy SQL only, no other way. Like entire application stack will be working in a proper manner, only this particular proxy server will be modified after adding one new slave here. So are we clear with that? So proxy SQL is a software within itself.
Sir, actually, like what software is there in this proxy SQL? It is a full database or like?
It is not a full database. Like we use, as we use Nginx as a like a proxy server in case of web servers. So same thing it is going to be. It does not have anything. It has only the particular way. It has the schema of MySQL database. This proxy SQL is going to have the schema of MySQL database, nothing else. Moreover, it will have some certain rules which are going to be responsible to decide whether the query is read-only or write or writing query it is. So based on those rules, it is going to do load balancing between master and remaining servers. So this is how we scale like database.
But sir, rules are set in this NLP,
No. So the particular rules for making decision like where to send the request. So let us say request is coming from here, like internal application server. Request will go to network load balancer. And whatever request comes, because see, we cannot set any sort of individual rules over here, like based on host or path. We can define like what is going to be port number of this particular target group, and that is it. Whatever request comes from here, it will be forwarded here. But in case of providing authentication and authorization, we have to define the particular username and password of this proxy SQL inside this application server.
Sir, I thoda sa clarify idhar janna chahunga. Sir, we have one proxy server, right?
Right.
And we have an NLP, sir. So, sir, internal app is an application server which has some business logic. Am I correct?
Yes, yes.
So, sir, ये हमें application server ये बताता है, like proxy SQL का port ये है, तुमको यहाँ जाना है. So, this configuration is in application
server. Am I correct? In order to connect to database, you will not directly define the details of database inside your application server. You will just notify your application server to connect with your network load balancer. Along with that, you will define a username and password as well of like along with network load balancer. Why it is so? Because as soon as request comes to network load balancer, it will forward to proxy SQL. Now proxy server will have.
Sir, username password proxy SQL ka, right?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, sir. Next, sir.
So after that, as and when request will reach out to your proxy server. Proxy SQL server. So proxy SQL server will be responsible to validate whether the request is authentic or not. Once it reads that request is authentic, so after that it will analyze whether the request which is coming to me is ready to update, insert, alter, or delete. if it is anything apart from like select, then it will forward the request to master server. Otherwise, it is going to forward all the requests to read-only slaves. And now all the requests are sent to these sort of like these sort of servers in like round robin fashion. Each server will be serving equal request.
अच्छा सर, जो रूल्स है कि रीड राइट करना है या आई मीन रीड होगा तो इट विल गो टू द राइट होगा तो आई थिंक इट विल गो टू द मास्टर राइट रीड होगा तो स्लेव पे जाएगा.
एवरी सिंगल ऑपरेशन रादर देन सिलेक्ट विल बी सेंड टू मास्टर ओनली.
सो दिस रूल्स आर डिफाइंड इन दिस प्रॉक्सी एसक्यूएल राइट.
यस.
अच्छा सर, वन मोर थिंग सर, जो रूल्स डिफाइन हुए हैं इट इज इन द फॉर्म ऑफ कॉन्फ़िगरेशन फाइल या लाइक सम ऑप्शन इज देयर
एसक्यूएल एसक्यूएल क्वेरी.
ओके, सो दिस इज डिफाइंड इन फॉर्म ऑफ सम एसक्यूएल फाइल और समथिंग.
यस 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 यस.
अच्छा, सो लाइक इट कम्स ओवर हेयर. ओके, एंड सर एनएलबी डजंट हैज एनी रूटिंग मैकेनिज्म राइट.
राइट राइट. नॉट नेटवर्क लोड बैलेंसर डज नॉट हैव एनी सॉर्ट ऑफ राउटिंग मैकेनिज्म एंड इट हैज रादर देन सेइंग लाइक इट डज नॉट हैव अदरवाइज हाउ इट इज गोइंग टू फॉरवर्ड ट्रैफिक टू दिस टू प्रॉक्सी सर्वर्स राइट. इट हैज राउटिंग मैकेनिज्म बट इट डज नॉट हैव अ फीचर वेयर वी कैन इंप्लीमेंट लाइक होस्ट बेस्ड राउटिंग पाथ बेस्ड राउटिंग एंड ऑल.
ओके, सो इट कैन व्हाट इट कैन डू इज जस्ट लाइक इट सेज दिस इज द पोर्ट. The request needs to go there. Correct?
Yes, that is it. Nothing else.
Oh, okay. And sir, like last question is, sir, you told like this request is going to suppose proxy which you saw 3389, right?
Right. Any port.
Achha, that we can decide in the configuration file also.
Yes,
right?
Like yes. Let us say whenever we are going to define the particular proxy SQL server, we can define that which particular port on which particular port proxy SQL is going to run.
Okay, so this port is defined, sir, like in kind of file only, right? Or
like I told you, like these are going to be like saved in form of like SQL. Like there will be a table where we are going to set these rules.
Okay. Like there will be table because sir,
buddy, as I told you earlier as well, this particular proxy SQL is going to hold the particular schema only, not the data of databases, but schema only.
Schema, so that will be in the schema. Yes. Schema file, sir, kaun sa format hota hai, sir? SQL format, okay. And sir, last thing is like you told like when it sends to any port which is defined in the schema. So sir, jab jo wapas jata hai, authenticate karta hai. So how this authentication is there?
Sure. So when request would come here, so now we have defined that if a request is going to go to like rather than read or maybe select. So what is going to happen when we define a particular server inside proxy SQL, like what is going to be actual endpoint? So we do not define only IP address, but we define port number as well. So actual server is running on port number 3306.
Yes.
So it is going to work, like it is going to accept traffic on like ABC IP address and port number is going to let us say 3389 and it is going to forward request on like XYZ IP address and the port number is going to be 3306. So this is not only going to like route the request, but it is going to change the port number as well. The actual server's port number will be known to this proxy SQL only.
Correct, sir. And this port forwarding mechanism is again a schema.
Yes. Like as we have rules in IP table, so same sort of rules we implement within that SQL table.
Okay, so this will be sort of role where yes, port forwarding.
Yes. This is going to be a rule inside your proxy SQL.
Okay. So, sir, that is okay. Like some port number, the request is coming, and then it is going to 3306. So, मतलब एक port से दूसरे port पे forward हो गया, and the request goes based on the mechanism of read and write. Correct?
Right.
From proxy. लेकिन sir, ये बीच की चीज़ है, sir. ये बता दीजिए. आप बता रहे थे authentication mechanism की like proxy SQL how it sends to the NLP. This thing.
So as I told you, like request will come.
Uh-huh.
From your application to network load balancer.
Uh-huh.
Now network load balancer will forward the request on any individual IP address and port where whatever this proxy server is running on.
Okay.
Now once the request is sent to this proxy server, now it will take decision that what is the IP address, what is the IP and ID of this master server. If Correct. It is rather than select, it will forward request here. Otherwise, request will be forwarded to this server in random order.
Okay, but sir, this is something like which is going to master thing. So this is the sort of acknowledgement NLP is getting.
So NLB is just going to forward request, whatever request are coming from here, it will accept and it will forward request here. Now authentication, let us say username and password will be verified at this particular level.
Okay.
If these are passed, then definitely it will forward request here, otherwise request will be rejected at this level only.
Achha, okay. So, okay, fine. So it is just username and password.
Yes,
okay.
Nothing else.
Okay. I was just thinking other things like how the port and all, maybe its mapping is happening.
No. It is not doing anything like that.
So username, password anyways will be there in NLB, right? So
not in NLB, proxy server.
Proxy server, okay. Why, fine. Yeah.
So, I understood. I'm not getting, like, why do you get confused with proxy and NLB?
Yeah. No, I got it. NLB will just have the port, right?
Yes.
In NLB,
we have only port where from like request is going to be forwarded. So rather than defining 5 to 6 different servers inside this sort of internal applications, we are using network load balancer here, and that is going to forward request to proxy, and proxy is going to define the based on the rule like select, update, alter, insert, and others. So based on that, we are going to define that what server we are going to use here.
Okay.
Yes. So guys, are we clear with the particular infrastructure architecture now? Or do we still have any query, like how we are going to explain it, like why do we use any tool?
That is clear, Lokin. Thank you so much for this explanation.
Now let me tell you in a nutshell that what sort of questions were there. Like the very first question was, like why did you opt to use Jenkins? Why not any other tool? So I said that based on the particular ability of my team and the particular skill set which they have, so I had to select the particular tool where the not only my team is capable enough, but yes, the particular documentation are also available, because we are going to use open source tool here, right? So in order to use open source tool, we cannot go to anyone in order to get the solution for that. So we have to rely on the particular documentation which is available over internet. So we do not only prefer to use that tool which our team is capable enough to handle that. Aside to that, we have to think of the documentation part as well. The documentation should be good enough available in order to use that tool. So how does the answer sound?
Yeah, cleverly we are saying that is not in our hands.
Yes, that is not in our hand, but obviously we cannot say that we are not the decision maker. We are saying
we are
going to select the particular tool based on two parameters, that the particular skill set which our team has, and second thing, the documentation should be available because we are going to use open source tool, right?
Yes.
Then after I was asked that what sort of configuration management tool we are using, so I said that Ansible. Then they said that why you are not using Chef or Puppet. So I answered there that Ansible is such a tool which is really easy to understand, and it can fulfill all your requirement based on the particular infrastructure. So right now we are not having 10,000 servers where we are going to like operate the thing. So we have like limited number of servers, maybe up to 1,000, and Ansible is good enough to handle up to infrastructure of 5,000 server. So although there is not hard and fast limit, but yes, if you have really huge infrastructure, maybe 10,000 or maybe 1 lakh servers you have, then you might go with more customization, which is really an option available with Chef or Puppet. Then after they asked me, okay, what sort of monitoring tool you are using? Then obviously the question was something like, okay, when you joined the organization, so what sort of monitoring tool company was using? So I said company was using like Nagios. But obviously Nagios does not provide that sort of robust monitoring. Aside to that, like Nagios becomes paid in order to get a very fantastic and editable GUI, so that becomes paid service. So in order to be, like remain open source 100%, so we opted to use Prometheus, and I was the one to suggest, and obviously like based on my suggestion, company asked me to do a POC on that. Once the POC was successful, then after we implemented in some non-production environment, when it was successful, so after that we rolled out the stuff to production as well.
Okay.
So how does the answer sound?
It's very good. So that your inputs are also added to the team.
So yes, guys, these are the sort of answers we have. And now, guys, I hope that I have explained almost everything, whatever is required to explain during your interview. Like, why do you use Redis? So that is requirement of developer. Why do you use NLB in order to do distribution of requests onto multiple application servers? Why do you use multiple auto-scaling groups here? One auto-scaling group is handling internal application server, one auto-scaling group is handling like front-end servers. Why do you use proxy? So proxy is going to be a decision maker in order to like select, in order to send request to multiple database servers. Because we cannot scale database horizontally, like horizontally. We can do this particular thing based on the particular, just a moment guys. Hello. So guys, I hope that is good enough for today, right?
Yeah.
So let us let us continue with some other topics tomorrow, right? And the particular question which you have, so definitely we are going to discuss.
Question on this topic, looking.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, like after explaining the infrastructure, what shall we say? What are your activities daily once you log into the environment?
Okay, so as soon as we log into environment, so first of all, if there is a specific requirement which is raised from some other users, maybe some user might be facing some challenges, so we focus on the particular tickets which are assigned to us. Otherwise,
what
if we talk
challenges?
Like if we talk about like on daily basis activities, so like taking care of infrastructure, monitoring infrastructure. Like if there is a particular task which is getting repeated again and again, so we have to plan for automation of that task. Then after doing deployment, ensuring maximum uptime of infrastructure, like checking disk related alert, taking care of infrastructure and service related alerts, like doing optimization of the services. So these are our daily tasks.
Can we have one more class detailed on these questions?
Yes, we can have, not a problem.
Sir, Bastion host can be said like Linux host or like Windows host, or like what you prefer.
It could be any machine which has two IP address, public and private. Moreover, it should have connectivity with remaining environment.
Okay. And sir, one more thing, like, sir, can you tell me like 10 to 15 very, very important metrics from monitoring point of view, and like what are the 10 top metrics you monitored for any, I mean problems or like this, like what do you feel are most important metrics, like can you tell me?
First of all, CPU, memory, disk, network, available disk space, then after the particular disk read, disk write IO, these sort of things we need to focus on. Aside to that, for example, like swap utilization, memory utilization, logged in users, number of processes running on the operating system, number of open threads on the operating system, like number of files which are currently open, maximum limit of open files, these sort of things we can monitor. And obviously, if you would like to go in more detail, so you can read this sort of like CPU, disk read, disk write, read operation, write operation, moreover network in, network out. Right, then after, if it is AWS, obviously status check. These are the particular things which we can monitor.
And sir, there was one question, like if suppose I am in USA and my team, I am team lead and my team is sitting here in India. So sir, I have some auto scaling on some like festival or something. Then can we, like how we use that cron job, sir? Sir, can you give a little idea on that, how we can use cron in the auto scaling, sir?
Just a moment guys, so if we talk about this auto scaling group, so there is a particular option which we have. So this option here is, okay, I have deleted that particular auto scaling group. So guys, there is an option here, so under that we can go automatic scaling. So we can say some sort of schedule action we can perform, create schedule actions when we want to improve desired capacity once, maybe cron expression you would like to have. These sort of options we have here, right?
Okay, fine. They were asking in way 5 days holidays are there, but you are not in office, so how you manage from home in next 5 days? You need today 5 servers, tomorrow 10 servers, you need like that.
So you can have a cron expression, or maybe you can have defined different policy once, every week, every 5 minutes, every hour, every day, this sort of cron expression you can have here, right?
Okay, we can schedule this and leave the office, right?
Yes. that is deleting it. I'll have to remove the particular configuration part from here. So guys, I hope the session has been informative, right?